Final speaker for today, Rafael Moneo. Rafael Moneo is a distinguished theorist, critic, pedagogue, and practitioner. He has taught amongst other schools at the Technical University of Barcelona, the Technical University of Madrid, and Harvard University, where he acted from 1985 to 1990 as chairman of the architecture department, and where he is currently the Josep Lluís Sert Professor of Architecture. His theoretical and professional work has been widely published and includes Theoretical Anxiety and Design Strategies in the Work of Eight Contemporary Architects from 2005, and Rafael Moneo Remarks on 21 Works, 2010. More recently, as a practitioner, Rafael Moneo's works include the Museum of Fine Arts in Houston, Texas from 2000, Our Lady of the Angels Cathedral in Los Angeles in 2002, the Laboratory for Interface and Engineering for Harvard University in 2007, and the Chase Student Center for the Rhode Island School of Design in 2008, the Beirut Souks Project from 2009, which is a personal favorite of mine, and the Princeton Neuroscience Institute, which houses the psychology and neuroscience departments at Princeton University, which opened in December of 2013. Rafael Moneo has been awarded numerous distinctions, among them the Pritzker Prize for Architecture in 1996, the Gold Medal for the Royal Institute of British Architects in 2003, and the Prince of Asturias Award for the Arts in 2012. And we're honored to host him here tonight at the AA to conclude our symposium. So please put your hands together for Rafael Moneo.
Thank you, Adrian, for your kind words, and just telling you that I am extremely pleased to be here and to share with all the colleagues this symposium on this, I wouldn't say old-fashioned, but for me, an old topic, is this topic of typology. I ought to tell you very plainly and clearly that when I was invited, that I didn't know exactly what I wanted to say. Lately, I thought that perhaps I should present three projects of myself, old projects, all of them from the late 60s, early 70s, where I used the concept of type, or I have in mind the concept of time when trying to solve all of these three projects with the notion of type as an active element or an active catalytic element to be considered as the design ingredient or a design beginning. But because I think that it was quite important to tell the students nowadays that the concept type wasn't only what has been thought. It's, let's say, one of the lectures today had this title, The Burden of Type. And type is also a concept that was born with this sense that was constraining the freedom of the architect, and yet to show that indeed out and preventing repetition and mimicking and replicating and just becoming this the concept that was reducing the freedom of care, instead of being a retardatory concept, that it could be understood as a positive one. And leaving aside, as has happened to me also, to live quite close to the discussion that that happened around the typology in the 60s and 70s, I thought that it would be worthwhile to remind you some other sources or some references explaining why architects felt so attracted by this concept in those years. And leaving aside, therefore, the rather well-known chronicle of the origins of the discourse about typology in the 60s and 70s, I would like to start with solving some issues within the intellectual atmosphere of those years, trying to identify some possible influences that underlie the interest in typology. For the Italian architects and theoreticians, most of them decidedly Marxists, typology had become the concept which allowed them to approach architecture as a positive science, as an alternative to the biased Hegelian model of architectural history. It should be pertinent to remind you that when the concept of type comes out in the 60s, in Italy, somebody like Bruno Sebi was adamantly opposed to it, thinking that whatever valuable piece of architecture was very much attached to an individual and should be considered almost like a work of art inside the rather Hegelian description of a category of a space that at the end was reaching to the fulfillment in somebody like Frank Lloyd Wright for Bruno Sebi. And therefore, when the typology appears as a rather objective element that hasn't to do with any ideological or personal implications, and instead was giving to the architectural science or architectural theory the status of the natural science, then it was truly welcomed by all the Marxist architects that, as I said, were most of them. And two different sources for understanding how the concept of typology appeared, how the concept of typology appeared, come to my mind, standing well above the studies of many geographers, structuralists, and sociologists of the time. All those studies came together for founding and upholding the idea of type. Obviously, geographers, or obviously those who have studied the city, trying to establish the relationship between the city form and types, were also helping to uphold such an attitude. But the very first influence that I would like to mention is George Kubler and his book, The Shape of Time. And I ought to recognize how astonished I was to find this book in my hands. It begins with this remarkable paragraph. Let us suppose that the idea of art can be expanded to embrace the whole range of man-made things, including all tools and writing, in addition to the useless, beautiful, and poetic things of the world. By this view, the universe of man-made things simply coincides with the history of art. It then becomes an urgent requirement to devise better ways of considering everything men have made. This we may achieve sooner by proceeding from art rather than from use, for if we depart from use alone, all useless things are overlooked. But if we take the desirableness of things as our point of departure, then useful objects are properly seen as things we value more or less dearly. I finish the quote. And among those things produced by mankind, we must include all that we have built and we call architecture. For anyone such as myself, intrigued by the nature of buildings, halfway between a functional tool and a work of art, The Shape of Time became essential reading. Its ambitious goal was to explain the world produced by mankind throughout time. Scenes, objects, works of art, and eventually buildings appear classified through series and type forms which evolve in time. And even more, the time past becomes visible in form. In other words, it's almost like time was deposited in forms, in objects, in such a way that the time has taken the form and the shape of all the objects that are around. Time is not just the circumstance that gives form to something in the terms of state gaze. Time is the true way in or the true substance that has become visible in the things we have in hands. As a consequence, the role of historian is to understand how the physical remainders of the past that reach us today define the shape of time. Time perceived through shapes that we captured when studying a series of objects or works of art. Time is legible through them. The historian tries to record the passing of time not by talking of events, but through the visible forms with which we live. And similarly, architects can see that buildings confirm this durability of forms when naming and classifying buildings by type. To recognize type forms is to be aware of being immersed in the true reality of time. To be aware of time as deposit in form is essential for the architects as well as craftsmen and artists. The expression to our feelings and thoughts in a specific moment is manifested in the form type inherited from others only to be modified with use. Kubler explains in his book, it's a very small, tiny book that still can be read with pleasure. Kubler explains in his book, it was published in 1961, and since then, I think that was a book of some remarkable influence, and by sure that has been read by Rossi and by those by all those who speak so highly and as type to be a mandatory subject in architectural theory. Kubler explains in his book The Way Things Leave Time Traces in Their Form. Let me offer another direct quote. I quote, "A pleasure shared by artists, collectors, and historians alike is the discovery that an ancient and interesting work of art is not unique, but rather that like there exist several examples that spread on time early or late, or that could be of high or low quality in versions that are either antitypes or derivatives, originals or copies, transformation or variation. Much of our satisfaction comes, in this case, from the contemplation of a formal sequence, of the intuitive sensation of prolonging and completion in the presence of a form in time." Kubler's contribution, I finish the quote. Kubler's contribution is the identification of tight forms which are produced as series. His interest in the evolution of these series brings him to explore how type forms can change as a result of innovation, either from new techniques or the unexpected formal contribution of an individual. Supported by his profound knowledge of pre-Columbian art and culture, Kubler is able to draw out the differences of what happened in chronological time between the forms of European culture and in the recently discovered civilizations. In other words, the works of art or the history of art can be written only synchronically, and we need to find out that it could happen in one culture. You take the Gothic balls who were exported to America at the beginning of 16th century. It meant that here the novelty when in Europe and even in Spain was a rather late constructive mechanism. Besides that, he intended to establish periods that allow him to look at the evolution of type form through time independent of conventional chronology. Thus, the scholar is able to follow the succession of generation of artists within a specific society whose work continuously follows the pattern of well-defined type forms. Needless to say that this line of thought attracted architects who considered their work as something inevitably immersed in time and far removed from the instantaneity and the unique identity that characterized the work of art. Architects know that they work with ideas embedded in type form, which are the beginning of all design. It is these non-type forms that receive their first design impulses, and gradually this process produces a natural displacement of time on them. Time captured in the physicality of the cities allows us to identify clear and distinct type forms and therefore explain how a book such as The Shape of Time could be welcome in the 60s and 70s for those architects interested in typology. To recognize the impact of a book like that is today an act of justice. Similarly, architects were also encouraged to think in typological terms by the discussion of methodologies sustained by the art historian. In a way, it can be said that architectural history was reduced to a bunch of people, let's say half a dozen of historians in those days with actual presence and impact, the studies of art history have developed a much more broader and, let's say, much more respected methodology, and architectural historians were very, very much taken by those methods used by his colleagues that are historians, and therefore it should be recognized that this fatal attraction of art historians' methodology was also present in inspiring all this issue of typology. After the critic attached to the strict pure visual consideration, which ended up in giving absolute priority to explore the formal world in which prevailed abstraction, perhaps Fiedler and Wolfflin, and lately in some terms Seve, are the most characteristic figures of the trend, of this trend, the more eclectic and culturally oriented group of the Warburg Institute, interested in looking at the work of art for its iconographic and iconological content, opening the door to a proper identification of the shared symbolic world behind them. Among them, the group of British and German scholars, Sals with Coward, Wund, Krautheimer, Blunt, Gombrich, to mention a few, sought to evaluate the meaning of art and what Panofsky defined as iconographic and iconological studies. The gaze upon the work of art now identifies the plots, the literary and metaphoric context which underlies the words, and reappears recurrently as a leitmotif, allowing the artist to establish a frame which could be considered as a beginning. The iconographic and iconological studies became a broad field which allowed the classification of works of art without losing the concept of singularity provided by each individual artist. Architects promptly felt that this concept of shared content could also be applied to the work they do, to the buildings. The concept of building type was the natural translation of what historians were doing when studying and classifying works of art. I believe this exploration of this approach by the art historians were very much in mind of the architects when thinking about typology during the 60s. It is not by chance that it was Giulio Carlo Argan, an art historian, to be one of the first in making use of this concept of type, just making the quote of Quatremers de Quincy that we have seen repeated three or four times today, making the use of this concept of that comes directly from Argan, who discovered that it exists, that even that exists the figure of Quatremers de Quincy. The issue with Durand would be quite different. Making use of this content, architectural criticisms and theory. Then, I think that before starting with my own work, that actually is the content, the modest, but very direct, and also you wanted even not so modest, that is just showing that types can, or the content of type could be understood not as the repetition at the end killed the concept at the late 70s, and in the early 80s it becomes almost connected and assimilated with postmodernism. And instead, something more profound was there, and that is what I would like to show in my own words, just running the risk or just presenting myself the way I did without, let's say, any academic network behind. But before that, I would like to go through very rapidly about this to remind you how probably it was worthwhile to speak about iconography and iconology as a reference for typology. I put together just a subject, the Annunciation, and I have taken just images from the Prado Museum. That means that you could multiply that by hundreds, even thousands of images like that. Those come exclusively from the Prado, and I could have taken even more than that, but let's think about some of them. They are the very famous early 15th century Frangelico, and you see there almost all the ingredients of the iconographic episode. You see the Virgin in his own house, as such a beautiful early Renaissance house with the door at the end, the carpet protecting her feet, and then with all this humbleness and this so, let's say, respectful, as well as it is the angel, and then the original scene, people running away, what is going to happen, that redemption, and just what has happened with the Paraíso, with the garden, then it's going to be changed. But then we can look at that. I'm sorry. We can look at that more carefully. We could pay attention to many more things, but we don't have too much time. I leave in the hands and eyes of the audience to make their own comments. Look at the beautiful hands and how respectful. Look at the small, just the witness of what is saying. Just as it comes, the dove is there, the much more humble bird waiting there. And obviously this, let's say, I was going to say typology, but this iconography comes out in much modest painters that it was Frangelico, and when you were looking at the master of an Aragonese painter, the Maestro de Torralba, but again, still the Holy Ghost, still the angel, still the Virgin in the same way. We will see things that has been added, and here, for instance, the very clear iconographic piece that is this band with the beginning of the gospel, Ave Maria, Gracia Plena, that we will see now. That then, obviously, the artist has in his hands how the band turns and runs, but it's still her house. And here, Campin, famous painters, 14th, first half of 15th century. Again, it is curious to see what in Florence and was this delicate the small house. Here is almost a Flemish palace with the Gothic balls, the steel, the Almighty above in the corner, the angel in a much more, let's say, stiff way, even without the closeness that we have seen in D'Angelico. Frangelico doesn't happen here. The Virgin seems to be interested in reading. And here, again, we are seeing another Spanish painter in a much modest way. We have seen the angel change, and we are appearing that is going to be almost a very characteristic piece, that is this symbol of virginity with the vase and the flowers, still the Virgin, not just as the humble maiden, and instead somebody who, even though she didn't expect such a visit, but is just making this sense of, let's say, of the sophistication that means the book. And again, here we are now in this Maestro de Sisa. He's also a Spanish painter under the influence of Flemish, this painting of Campin that we have seen, that we are still seeing the base and the flower, and yet you see the basket, the Virgin walking and still reading, the angel quite beautiful to see again the closeness of both heads and the band that we have seen before. And here again we are in an anonymous painting of the beginning of 16th century. In this moment we are seeing some and again we are in the first half of 16th century. You know always that the half that you see again the base and again the angel bringing the Virgin and here Díaz de Correa de Vivar, a Spanish painter, a bit more theatrical somehow with the Virgin, and again the Virgin in Morales. You look at that, and again, you realize that difficult. Don't say that the image is just following some pattern, some plot, some literary account that allow many things. Because you look at the Morales, you are able to value here and to recognize the influence of Leonardo da Vinci, those sfumato and all those. Obviously, it hasn't the depth of the Italian, and yet, even though the individual freedom is kept, I will say that the presence and the importance of the plot allows to make this parallel with the typology or with type. This is obviously. Anybody is just giving the list of the pieces to happen. Here, for instance, is a Fransonius, a Dutch painter of beginning of 17th century. Here is much more curious because it seems almost to be something like a contract that here you will have some kind of change of what could be understood as a typological, even though many things have been kept, is still the book, still the base that we have seen how it appears, still the holy gods and so on. Here there's a Spanish painter. We are now Correa de Vivar with Carducho, Spanish second range painter. Here we have a drawing from a Spanish painter also beginning of 17th century, Palacios, and a wonderful drawing by Alonso Cano, painter contemporaneous of Velázquez, with all the Baroque in a way. You see the plot that hasn't been left, and yet it happens in a much more theatrical way. You are also seeing the drapery that came from the Venetian painters, and the Virgin, the angel is taking another different position to the Virgin, even though the Virgin still keeps the ingredients of the episode. Some architectural piece in the reclinatory where the Virgin is waiting for the angel. And here we have, this is Pereda, that is another painter, and rapidly another, here we have Murillo, and a wonderful drawing by Murillo that speaks about how whoever had in mind that he needed to say something like that, then later all that will happen. And obviously because it was the fourth centenary of the Greco that was passed away 1614, and we are celebrating that, I put together the annunciations from El Greco. That they are not all of them in El Prado, there are some, but some others are in different museums. But that's so wonderful that obviously you see here more the splendor of the artists working in this abstract world of shapes, and then even though art being kept, the basket with the scissors and the needles and the draft, and then later the flowers and the angel, and then here, and that is the last one. Just extraordinary, as you see. The images that comes now are coming from the illustration from Kubler. And then Kubler is explaining us what happens with all those pre-Columbian pieces. And obviously what he says, you see, don't look at that just as objects with value in itself. What happens is that what we are seeing is actually the time. The time is there. It was a time that lasted 3 or 4 centuries, making the craftsmen the same kind of base and making those changes that you are able to imagine the wheel and why we are bending or just turning, and well, and then the same happened. This is pre-Columbian from the Kubler. And then you are seeing whoever is doing that makes all those pieces. You are able to be taken by a single one you have in you, even in your hand, and yet all of them belongs to this way of thinking in a mask that actually allow this speak time as taken form. It's not just the time. What let's say forces the artist is the time itself, which actually is materialized by those pieces, and then those are Mycenaean, and those are Mycenaean that I couldn't prevent myself of just putting those pieces in its beauty, that you are able to find out that the evolution of a shape like that is something that happens. Let's say with the enjoyment of time that actually feels how he is going to be present in the future, just remaining the physicality of a piece like that. And then I arrived to the actual core of the presentation, that is myself. The other thing is just to accomplish first with what is supposed to be some academic contribution, that was just to remind you how these two quotes could help to find out the atmosphere of the 60s. Now, I think I ought to mention something else, because I think that in the symposium we have missed the very important point of the typology, that is the relationship between morphology and typology. If something at the end has remained of what the typology meant in the 60s and 70s, is this ability we have nowadays of looking at cities, just trying to establish this continuity between what could be said the cells that are providing to the largest pieces to be part of a broader structure. Now you have here, that is Barcelona, that is the quintessence of the city block. And you see in all those city blocks how the unifying, let's say, broader superstructural grid is holding some independent lives of each of them, that they still keep the traces of property, as well as allow to all those divisions to uphold the houses that have its own entity. And obviously, the block itself is allowing, let's say, regularity in the diversity that comes from the rural property that had another direction. And therefore, when you take, you see here this line, it's just showing you what used to be the land property before. It was superimposed what is a block. And yet the block, you see there houses, and each of them just respecting. You are able to find out this piece of land that had been divided in four sons and daughters, and then later each of them raised on whatever they wanted. And then I thought to say that obviously the decorum, or what is the way they are going to, what the blocks are going to happen or are going to appear, it depends upon the rules and the norms and the codes, establishing heights or establishing rapport or relationship with windows and full walls and so on. But then the later still Barcelona, but you could imagine that somebody wanted, because they had one complete property, that they wanted to have one block made at once. That there is a moment when regularity outdoors, that has been tented many times, comes out also with some regularity inside. And here, but what happens is that at the end, the architect wasn't able to overcome because here is unitarian block, but then later the actual thing is that the block is keeping the structure of these blocks, because each one you would be able to subdivide each block in so many slices as the houses are there. In a way, the regularity is true, that irregularity outdoors in the perimeter, but isn't the unitarian lure or the attempt to be with a unique form isn't satisfied inside, because inside you are also going to divide. You are not able to move from one to the other. The continuity is broken, and the unity is somehow fictitious. And then I will show you that this is a block in Valencia, where in 1933 it happened that somebody wanted to build all at once this piece of land. And it happened the same that I explained to you now, that they did indeed, that is called the Kaiser Rosa, they indeed this the house as it was a single piece, unitarian single piece, and yet you know how it was built, this quite impressive view of 1933, and you see the interior again, and yet this sense of unity that happens here is just hidden behind this partition and this way of being sliced, and even in also curiously, we are also in 1933, we are in Madrid. That is a very well-known architect from the 30s and 40s and 50s, Zuazo, Secundino Zuazo, and he made this complete block. And for making this complete block that appears now as a continuous, a unitarian piece, actually he couldn't do that. He did the same. Obviously, he's taking something like a block. It's an effort here, quite a valuable effort. Something like a block splits in slices and fragments and portions, makes something in the heads with a different head, north, south, make this kind of courtyard transform in a garden. And again, we are going to see the house as a continuous house, and yet it is going to be divided this way and this way, the way you are seeing there. Here is still his drawing, showing that actually the sense of unity he's looking for, it didn't happen, and yet it is sliced and cut it the way you are seeing. And here is Zuazo, 1933, Zuazo. Now the issue is, what is or isn't possible to have a block that has the sense of continuity that makes the block unable to be split. That is the problem that I got just when working in this house in San Sebastian in 1966-67. That means Arquitectura de la Città by Rossi was published in 1996. Nothing to do with that, but that means that the sense of that I was working trying to solve some problem in typological terms was there. And was there that the house was half a block in a wonderful location. Happily, I had later the fortune of building the Cursal just 100 meters away. And just recently I have built a small parish in the later meander of the Urumea. That means I felt myself quite fortunate, as I said, being in the short of this river with the three works. But and here comes that. Obviously, when I did that, I assumed that I was going to work entirely in the block, because the other half of the block didn't belong to us. But I would like, to explain you now how we did for achieving this continuity that I was talking about. And then, let me see, you look at one of those slides, they take that and take that. And then there is a moment when you have here an elevator, and you have there just another elevator that goes directly to the kitchen. From this elevator, you enter into the living room. From this other, you enter into the kitchen. You are not sharing, you are sharing this stair with the house on the left, and you are sharing this elevator with the house on the right. That means that you are unable to cut that in a slide. But by so doing, you are just providing continuity to all the houses in a way that it solves the problem of a block that has a unitarian structure in the houses forming the block. Obviously, it's just, if you wanted even an academic endeavor to do that. If I don't explain that, anybody pay attention to that, because at the end, the house is a rather a conventional, but a very good, very valuable house, because you enter from here, and you enter to the living room and dining room, and you enter from here into the kitchen and office and dressing room, and then you go to go, what in the rather conventional houses, that is a corridor. This corridor comes with throughout something like a family room with this courtyard, and then later you have two bedrooms into this private courtyard and another four bedrooms that go to the larger courtyard. The advantage of this house is that at the end you are owing the courtyard. It's a private courtyard. You don't see from here, you're not facing other neighbors, but you are just keeping in your all horizontal holdings of all the privacy that doesn't allow you with your eyes directly into another house. In a way, you look at both. Here we are 120 meters in Barcelona, here we are in 70 meters, roughly 70 meters. Both are in the same scale. But that means that this house has this fictitious unity around, and this other is indeed representing, and obviously we have cut the house this way, because they are actually the house is cut this way. In the actual house that has been built, the latest house has some kind of specificity for allowing to prevent the existence of the next one that was needed to follow it up. But when you are making the exercise of drawing the house, you are able to draw the house in complete continuity. You see here the house. That is a bit more sophisticated in the corners, because in the corners, the mechanism, you have freight elevator, elevator. When you come to the corner, you come directly into inside the houses with this elevator. The same here, it happened, the elevator is shared by two houses, but in this case, you enter directly there, and this service stair with the its own elevator allowed to enter to all three pieces, one that is a small one, another one, and the third one. So allowing turning around and establishing this continuity that I said. And here, that shows you clearly this scheme that, as I said, allows to solve this problem of the unitarian. Obviously, here, that is the difficulty that this kind of house has. We have the actual house is cut this way, but and have two entrances. But in the case that it was the entire block, you will have all those, and then you will have this corridor all around with some offices just facing the street, and then later some available spaces just above the courtyard. But let's say that in a project like that, actually, difficult to think that the architect didn't have the awareness that he was overcoming some typological problem, and that was that what was pursued here. Obviously, that without explanation, as I said, nobody paid attention to it. But actually, it was the type consideration which helped us to solve this problem. Now we are going to see. This is a project that I made with Manuel de Solá Morales. Unfortunately, passed away 2 years ago. Who was a urban designer and professor of the urban design in Barcelona. I learned a lot from him, and we made together the conservation plan for this city. This is a city in the south of Madrid, something like 40 miles away, going south. That is the Tajo, and it was a royal headquarters, a royal summer palace. The palace was there, the services were there, and was built almost at once in 1760, 1780. And it was built with a rather quite clear understanding and knowledge of this, that they were making those blocks that very rarely can be called blocks. But there, soon we have seen in the presentation of Tarsha, we have seen something about blocks and how blocks could be subdivided and how blocks could be invaded by different houses solutions. Here, we started drawing quite carefully everything, and we understood very rapidly how the city has been built, because it has been built with the system of with a system of base that is the, let's say, the original rectangle, and then imagine that you come here with a double bay, and then you come here another double bay and another double bay, but here the house is like that. That means that you have two double bays there and there, and then there the side blocks are always a single bay, and that the Mitoyan wall is also one single bay and single bay, but above the on the street double bay, and then that is the way it came from here into here. That means that the builders or the architects knew perfectly that the small nuances and small changes and small divisions could get this sense of regularity if at the end you respected just this simple formula of just keeping the system of base for the structuring the, and then we decided now I just will show you that we are providing rules and norms for allowing who was the owner of this piece to build whatever they are keeping, as I said, the double bay and the single bay, and so allowing. And actually, that was made in 1974, has been still alive and still has been kept. And here we are just showing those which are monuments, those that should be kept because they didn't need any intervention and should be simply kept. And what remains after overlapping that and that were those where the intervention could be followed after, as I said, the rules that we established with the true knowledge of what happened with the type. Therefore, that is a work, isn't, let's say, something, it's not something, anything to do with artistic work, to establish the norms for just keeping the village or the city like Aranjuez. It is just something where what has been asked to the architect is knowledge, not just pouring his or her own, individuality. Here we are coming with the third one. We are talking about 1974, more or less the same years, and still with suddenly disappeared friend Manuel de Sola Morales. That is Vitoria, a beautiful city in the north of Spain, a medieval city that was enlarged in the, let's say, early 20th century into there, and in the years of Spanish development, 60s, and started to happen all these things that you are seeing there. And it was the competition for building up this large block. And we won the competition, Manuel de Sola Morales and myself. And we won this competition again, just as a clearly, with a sign that clearly has an origin in the notion of time. We very much wanted a neighborhood who was structured at once with the street system and the type of housing. In a way, we didn't want just what happens. What happens in many of these others where actually you don't see there the structure related with the units. Here, being able to have at once, the unité d'habitation, the house unities, as well as the road system, as well as solving corners and so on, was from the beginning. That means that we started from a type, a quite long type, that was the duplexes with the bay between the 18, 16 feet and 20 feet, more or less. And then these duplexes that was in the origin, we needed to overlap another layer just for getting the wanted density without, without falling into the single slab or the single block, and instead just working with that. And that is what we did. And as you realize, the main roads that are more roads than the streets are completed with these roads that are dividing by half the surface, and then later having these unities, because I will advance you that in this case you are entering each unities like that. If we came back here, you will see here a unity is like that, and another unity comes from this road here and is like that. That means here is only pedestrians, and the vehicles, streets or roads are, as I am saying, just having this piece and the other, this one and this other one here. And then, beside that, these two streets are defining something like a central park that everything moving there is able to move. Those are the pedestrians, those are the vehicles, and here you have the vehicles as well as there. And then here you have the each of these unities, you are entering, here is the road, and you have here, you are entering into the parking garage, that is the, and here is a unity, and here you have another entrance to the parking garage, in this other side. And then it, the unity is like that, and here you have those houses that I was talking about. In this case, you have, you are entering from here, you have the parking garage, here are the gardens, from there you are entering into the parking garage, are displaced slightly because so we are in coincidence with the direction of the parking. You are not connecting both, that means that this one has this entrance and this one has this other entrance, and then in this that is the general section. The general section, you see there the parking, these duplexes that are here, one system of stairs that allow you to go up, and either another duplex above or just two independent apartments with all that roof public space that enhances and promotes this sense of community that we were looking for. That means that in this case, the type should be handled in such a way that, that at the end allow it also, let's say, configure it and to provide and give form to this broader unity of house unities, as well as the addition of those house unities around the park, the entire neighborhood. I mean, I like it when I saw also Tarsha, and we have seen the 1930s proposals. In a way, here we move a step further in just using the blocks. Here you are reading also like blocks, but actually the structure is in the other sense, in this sense of those double duplexes structure that I said. You are able to foresee there the roof cover that we suppose, and we would like that to have promote and enhance the communal life of the people living there. And you have the other thing, the other side, and moving through there, you are able to go through the park just for pedestrian, as well as cars are moving this way and this other way, as I said. The corners were just for all services and so on. I think that there is a difference with... I think that there is a difference between what we have seen in the New York that was more radical in the 30s, just this confidence. In this case, the type ought to be handled and manipulated in such a way that it is able to produce the more sophisticated whole, the sophisticated neighborhood, or whatever you want to call it. And here you see more clearly again. And here, that just explains quite clearly why we are able to speak about typology. You have this, this is the cell, those 480 meters, between 480 and 6 meters. One stair that happens to be here in this case, just running longitudinally in the axis of the houses. And then from there, you have four ways of dealing with the secondary stairs. The secondary stairs, you have there in this direction, parallel to the longitudinal main stairs, or just being perpendicular, or just having a double flight in one direction, or a double flight in the other direction. And then you come here with the different possible partitions, and then it comes that from this stair, you will be able to come with all those 1, 2, 3, 4, 12 and then 48, just starting from this stair with all these different sections, and you come out with this matrix that obviously is an exercise that speaks about the known typology could be developed or handled or whatever you want to call it. Here, just when you are changing the stair, the main stair, it will happen again something else. Here, just some images of the houses. You have the entrance. You are coming out from some independent stairs from the parking here. The main stair goes this way. You enter from there. And here is this one floor and a half. This one floor and a half coming kitchen, small dining room, living room, the stairs that goes up, and then two bedrooms there, plus another bedroom that happened in the lower floor. And then you come here, you are coming in the second one, you are entering from here into the house, the kitchen, the living room, and then you go up, and then you have those four. And then the latest one, you have reached this stair that leaves you there. And once you are there in this point, you enter throughout this stair because you remain in the lower floor, and being left in the lower floor, you go up into this stair and appears there, and you have that smaller one with two bedrooms. And here you see a model with the section that shows how the intricacies and how these variations they could happen. And here another view. Here is the covered space that I was talking about. Obviously, you could relate a piece like that, like Peter Hodgkinson project for Bloomsbury, for instance. There are many attempts in those days were done, but probably not so many, so carefully and carefully handled as was this one, that were, as I said, it didn't move just from a simple block, but instead it was creating this almost a small city. There were so many as 2,000 houses, but unfortunately, we ended up, Franco's death happened in 1975, then the conflicts started to happen in the north of Spain, and the project went out in spite that we have won the competitions, and the owners, that was a saving bank, was very happy with the project. And here, one more view. Here, the small courtyards or the small gardens that we value so much, and the streets and so on. And I guess that this one is the last one. And I just, I ought to end, just telling you how all these three projects are showing how typological mind is able to be useful for an architect without falling into simple iconic repetition of something that, as a matter of fact, a lot of those Italians just fell down in this way of making neighborhoods, just making, let's say, regular windows as in traditional architecture, and yet without, let's say, taking the concept in a broader sense, that is what seems to me that is still that justified in those days and still justifies the value of a concept like that. And I think with that, I feel thank you.
Thank you very much. Can we take a few minutes while I invite the speakers from today to come up to the front? And we're going to have a panel discussion for about half an hour or 40 minutes. But you just need to give us a moment while we reorganize the tables and chairs. So bear with us.
Can you raise that?
Do you need to plug in some PowerPoint?
I don't know. But we could just raise that.
or turn it off if you don't need it, right?
I don't know if you need it or not. I just want to take it up right now.
Yeah, but do we need any PowerPoint during the...
No, I don't think so.
Yes, that's all right. Then I'll sort it. It's all right.
Is it possible to erase the screen?
Yes, you can do it.
From here,
no? No, I'll do it back. Yeah?
Yeah, I think that's... There's a difference between fresh air and freezing air. I was so pleased that you talked about Google.
No, he's going to punch me.
I'm going to throw myself across the table. No, no.
I should be wearing a stripe, black and white stripe.
I think so. Might as well, right?
Okay.
So what's your
dream?
Like,
my dream is called Fast Game.
I'm sharing, so.
I
Okay, so, well, thank you for bearing with us, and welcome back. So I thought I might start off the panel discussion with some quick comments and maybe a question to our speakers before opening it up to the audience. First of all, I want to say I was incredibly pleased that Rafael opened up with a description of George Kubler's The Shape of Time, which is kind of a surprising, in many ways, opening, because I think it's a book that in fact has a kind of incredible potential that has never quite been absorbed within architecture, certainly not in recent times, although that may not be the kind of case in the 60s or the 70s. And I think particularly the themes of repetition over time and Kubler's account of objects existing in sequence, a certain form class existing in sequence, and that one never speaks of an object in a way in the kind of purely individual sense, that each object somehow congeals a historical series within it, and then the work of, let's say, the analysis to somehow unpack that historical series is kind of incredibly relevant. But the question I want to ask, in a way, I guess, follows on from that. I think what I found really interesting today is a kind of sensibility that was shared amongst the different presentations, which is to describe relatively small, subtle shifts in projects that exist over time. No, there was never really a kind of account of kind of radical break or change, but in fact, you know, small changes that demanded a kind of struggle on one level, that were almost imperceptible in their presence if they weren't explained to you, and perhaps also imperceptible in their effects outside of a kind of academic context like this one. And so the first question is maybe also very simple but perhaps difficult, which is how do we start to talk about change typologically, and how do we recognize change typologically, and how do we begin to speak about it?
Well, from the three projects I have presented today, probably the only one that adds something new is the project in San Sebastian. The project in Vitoria, I would say that has to do more with an idea of urban planning, that this idea of congruency between network of streets and the geometry of the ways allowing people to move either by car or as pedestrian, and the shape or the architecture itself, in a way, buildings and urban design makes or achieves this congruency that this was we were looking for, and then this congruency happens, providing the structure that is both the structure of physical consistency as well as the social structure. Had the neighborhood been built, it would be interesting, don't say wonderful, to see how those units are able to provide this sense of closeness, and how the easiness of reaching the park, and just keeping this, let's say, respect to the car. It seems to me so important in today's architecture to include the car as something that deserves to be treated better than we do, that just providing this sense of continuity between the parkings and the housing and the public spaces and so on seems to me. But I wouldn't say that there is novelty. There could be, in the best of the cases, skill or ability for designing, but not just making something that could be said as new. Instead, the experience of San Sebastian is something completely new. In a way, as always you learn from others, probably I have learned that it started to be usual in some houses by Coderc to enter the main stair, to enter just almost in the house itself. What has another inconveniences? I think that it's always good to have a stair close to the elevator. But if you admit that you enter with the elevator just in the core of the house, then you are able to establish this alternance between entrances, and then the stair is making the division between two houses, but without isolating one from the other, because the other is related in the other side, and that means that you are just in a way weaving and the case of Aranjuez is in some way was easier once that you have analyzed and understood how the city has been formed. We said, well, let's keep the things the way they are and show and teach people throughout the code what they should do for respecting conservation. And then, actually, it has been working almost 40 years now, and I guess that they are going to extend for a period of another 25 years now, the scheme we did, the plan we did. Therefore, changes in type or just the new typological proposals, not so many. Let me say that the case of San Sebastian was of the very few that I have done. I have to some others. For instance, I have to say that in the Los Angeles Cathedral, the inversion of the chapels, the fact that they decided also by urban design conditions that you enter into the cathedral from the abside, then that inverted or forced me to invert the location of the chapels. And then the chapel, instead of opening directly to the main nave, are opening to some kind of deambulatories or corridors. That makes the plan of Los Angeles as something that is truly new. But many other things, I don't remember many other true novelties in my career.
Tasha, Chris, would you like to address the question?
The question of change.
Yeah.
No, I think.
For
me, it's pretty simple. I think it comes back to what Giulio Argan has said, right? I think if I quote him correctly, he would say that a type would seem to have arise when we could detect a series of building objects that share certain characteristics. So that is to say that a new type can only be detected after a certain period of time has passed, right? When certain objects, buildings, etc., share a common characteristic. So, and I think in that sense, working typologically also in a way is a constraint that allows an architect or a designer to resist the tendency towards novelty, right?
So is it almost that the type is, it only becomes a type once it's no longer associated with a name?
When it is not an act of singular, an act of singular genius or idiosyncratic creation, perhaps, right?
But it can be said that there are no many novelties out of the types either.
Yes, because correct.
I wouldn't see so many new things.
Correct. Correct.
It's very difficult to find out something that actually there are no precedences.
But I think that's because real newness is so rare, and I think also that's why several times today it's been quite surprising to me we've come back to Korb's 5 points. You know, it was raised 3 or 4 times this morning that if we're to follow Colhoun's argument about the displacement of concepts, that I think as you're saying, there's this transformation along a trajectory that can only be read through a series, not a singular project. But there is a moment where I think transformation sort of builds up. There's a where one can read that, and I think the 5 points is one of those moments where we might agree with Kipnis that the 5 points collaborate to undo the privileged status of the ground. You know, this is that's one of those moments. But I agree that it's a trajectory. Can be read as a series, not as a
But aren't we, I think maybe Sam will agree with me, but wasn't part of the sort of important point of reasserting the importance type is to go beyond that distinction between individual creation and commonality? Wasn't that the idea of approaching type as diagram, and that we're trying to get past that and trying to think of a new way of thinking about creativity and common culture? Or, so that division between, that divide between individuality and individual genius and creativity and the sort of like common denominator, isn't that what we were trying to go beyond?
I think it's this kind of underlying struggle, right, or the tension that exists. And I think, I was trying to explain it through, I guess, the art historical origins of the discourse. And I think it comes back through Semper, I think, who has an art historical / archaeological argument. And I think, of course, Semper then influences someone like Riegel and Riegel, but also I think he's very close to someone like Faucillon. And of course, those get connected later by someone like Kubler. And I think this is where you can also see there's a certain trajectory within the art historical discourse that precisely, I think, talks about that, right? I mean, and I think it's slightly easier than architecture, I think, in that sense, right? Because what you start to understand is that this kind of what they call life of forms, right, and both, I think, Semper as Faucillon does, is actually something that what I was trying to call sort of a typal motive, right, and which, of course, is also can be an artistic motive. And there's something very collective about it. But of course, also within the work of art, we know there's also the individual within that. Right? So I think that's the kind of tension. Yet, I think where Semper, I think, is quite paradigmatic is what he also provides is an explanation of the style. Right? I think sort of, again, sort of the tension between a style, which is, of course, a much more collective problem, versus a manner in which an artist will work. Right? So I think there's always that. In between there, and I think that's why, to me, still I believe that the question of, let's say, the diagram, I think, is precisely one of the mechanisms to start to think through the problem. And now, of course, I guess there's a question of, you know, how literally do you take that diagram, right? And I think again, I think that tension always exists. I mean, some people will draw a diagram and think that's the building. Now, I think what you showed, right? That kind of topological diagram. I think that's sort of that kind of level how I would understand the diagram, right? That becomes quite effective for design. Now, I think, again, it has two things. On the one hand, a kind of collective, right? I think something that I would say is the topological problem that gets addressed. And on the other hand, of course, also something that's an individual interpretation of it, right? And I think both elements are very important to it.
No, just I guess, you know, I said that, in my view, we have neglected, or at least we don't have given to the relationship between typology and morphology in growing and in creating the city. I guess that would be the field where typology would be more indisputable. Mm. In that at the end, and as a matter of fact, I would say that is one of the territories where you will find more material to explore. And had you asked, let's say, whoever wanted to show the richness of those of putting, or the potential of putting in relationship the imprint and the footprint of a city and the types that are inside it, I will have produced indeed the very fruitful and very clear understanding that the type is inherently and it is just ingrained with the idea of cities, and therefore if still types give us to think about in our inability to be so precise to understand exactly what it means, I will say that in the field of morphology, the type is quite a valuable concept, and that I would like to leave that statement on the table.
Can I ask, Rafael, in the morning session, you made the statement which was very striking for me, that the type is unrepresentable. I mean, I was struggling about how to understand that. Can you elaborate?
I see that I wanted to say something like the type exists when you are seeing many buildings at once that are something in common, that is this inapprehensible type. I like better to see the type, not without telling me this is the basilica type. I like better to see hundreds of basilica churches and then allowing me to think that underlies a type, that just telling me that the basilica is a type.
So that's why you showed the enunciation.
And this point of view, I would say that even though it isn't so clear to explain what had in mind Kubler when saying that all things are just, let's say, maintaining alive the time, that is what somehow he's saying, I would say that the types are living in so many things that deserve to be considered members of a class, but not, in my view, I would say that I wouldn't in this moment allow myself to say this is this type of building. I am able to think that I am starting from the type that I know, but I am, how you will draw the, let's say, the duplex bay that I have talking about. I resist myself from making the drawing of that, even though I know what it is.
But the drawing that you showed, you know, that Sam just made, it was necessary for you to communicate the idea.
I made just the simple allusion that it was a system of dimensions that allowed to install there some kind of house. But anyway,
that's part of the process of clarification, right? I think, and especially, I think, in a pedagogical didactic environment, a very necessary one. Perhaps in practice, I think these problems, of course, can be resolved slightly differently, because I think in some ways you kind of draw from your own knowledge. But right, I think there is sort of a question of communication where then these types of drawings, in fact, become quite central.
Okay. We might turn it over to the audience. There must be quite a few questions. So who would like to start? Yes, Simon.
I'll throw on it, you guys.
Microphone.
It seems to me somewhat that we're having, as architects, well, on the one hand, we're having a lot of trouble describing type, but on the other hand, we every day work within a set of conditions that describe type implicitly, such as building codes, client briefs, the real estate market. All of these external forces are actually much more instrumental in type. Is architecture the best profession to be thinking typologically?
I think the only way forward for negotiating the dispute amongst all of those groups is the architectural drawing. And I think that's been its role through the 20th century. It's the only mechanism that we have that really has developed our capacity to fight about that stuff without killing each other, which is part of a sort of spatial reasoning. You know, Shawai has noticed that, you know, there's this incredible banality to the idea that now we reason through space. You know, but it's a really profound thing, and we do it through the architectural drawing, and it allows us to pull all of those amazingly diverse interests into the drawing. And you certainly see that when you look at New York in any detail, of the incredible diversity of interests, particularly to do with real estate, labour, economics, and the provision and problem of housing, and the fact that housing almost just gets left off the map, but becomes actually in the end gets brought back in because it's a kind of useful thing for allowing other completely unrelated interests to keep operating in the city. So it's, you know, the thing, the massive housing programs that get rolled out in America and in New York in the 40s and 50s are actually almost like a byproduct of these other interests, yet we see them as central now to the way that the city emerges. So yeah, I think it's the architectural drawing.
Well, since you asked, is architecture to... I'll just take a very simple stab at this, and I do agree and see your anxiety, because as you said, on the one hand, one struggles with the various definition of type, and there's sometimes hair splitting arguments about what is type and what is typology and what is not, and in a sense, it disables the larger instrumentality of type, right? And if I have to really simplify it in a sense to make it more instrumental, I would say type is a very useful concept for an architect, a designer, to locate commonalities. Why is it important to locate commonalities? So that you could bring together different objects, different buildings that share certain characteristics, and then compare and draw lessons from that. Now, inherent in the comparative method, which is absolutely central to typological thinking, is all the issues that, Tasha, you're saying, that its transformation, its shared characteristic, is not purely geometric. It is influenced by real estate, it is influenced by political decisions, cultural norms, and so on and so forth. So I think in its most instrumental way, I would say, let's think about type as a concept that allows us to seek out commonalities. And seeking out these commonalities can occur at different levels, right? From the formal level, tectonic level, to the larger issues of the way in which we think of society, think of the city, and so on and so forth.
Can I just go back to something you said at the beginning there? Because I think it's really interesting, the idea that these externalities disable type. It was something about disabling. And I'm just wondering whether there was ever a time when architecture was entirely and fluidly enabled. Because type to me seems to be a thing that allows us to negotiate the interior and the exterior of architecture. It's a kind of a middle ground.
Yes.
And that's its real value.
Yes.
But it means then also that the discipline has a kind of limited autonomy in how it can act. Type is the thing that negotiates that.
Sure.
Right, and so has there ever been a time when the discipline has been enabled entirely rather than being...
I think we are all in agreement here of the instrumentality of it, otherwise we won't be here, So I would say absolutely, otherwise we won't be talking about...
My point just was, there's never been a time when we haven't been constrained by those things, and type hasn't been the instrumentality that negotiates them.
Yeah. Yes, yeah. If it, taking from this point, yes, I would agree. Even in the sense that even if we look at architectural modernism, you know, even in its most dogmatic fashion, we could see that there is actually a certain typological evolution going through Hume, in a sense, right? He terms it as the displacement of concept. I would say absolutely.
Yes, Sahan. Just wait for the microphone.
I sort of have a related question to that. Just does type or typology rely on the autonomy of architecture as a discipline?
Does type or typology rely on the autonomy of architecture?
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. I think I mentioned it very briefly. I think especially in the 60s, and with someone like Rossi, of course, it was used as an argument for the autonomy of architecture. But what I was trying to say is really, it never does, right? But I think there are two things. One is sort of historically, at least, I think that's the point when there is a claim made that architecture has a knowledge. And of course, that has much more to do with a much longer sort of classification of the arts, right? So I think that, in that sense, yes, right? And of course, that can only happen by making a claim for autonomy. Now, I think when it then gets sort of regurgitated sort of in the 1960s, it's suddenly meant to do something quite different. And I think, I mean, to put it very, very briefly, right, I think, of course, it's never is about the autonomy, because in fact, if you look at it more closely, it depends on so many other things, right? So I think it's, in fact, it's only helpful at a particular moment in time to conceptually make a claim.
Yeah, I mean, I just want to pick up on that maybe and ask a question to Rafael, because I think one of the odd things about Kubler's argument, for example, is that, I mean, he would never talk about the autonomy of the discipline, but he would certainly talk about form having a certain autonomy, or in a way, a kind of life of its own beyond its producers. And I wonder whether, how you, I mean, I think that there's a kind of tension in Kubler. On the one hand, a form is always a response to a certain kind of problem, right? So the problem always becomes a kind of genetic condition of form. But then on the other hand, forms seem to acquire a kind of life of their own, a kind of independence of their makers in some way.
I don't think that in this moment architectural autonomy makes too much sense. Mm-hmm. And I wouldn't say that the idea or what the way I like to understand what is behind Kubler expression is, I don't think that forms are aliens to those who produce them, and they don't have life by themselves. I mean, as a matter of fact, the sense of series, the sense that you don't have such a clear an archetype, but just the contrary. You need to see things as in this continuity that seems to express this the way we experience time is against this sense of autonomy. I guess that this autonomy as a concept introduced in the 60s, probably with a certain radicalism, even if it's a radicalism that was in Rossi himself, I would say that he was trying to give, let's say, architecture the status that didn't enter in conflict with fashion. I mean, in a way, he was trying to think in a more Pythagorean way, even more than Platonic. It's almost like you were able to assume numbers or just very structural figures with a life and an ability to engender by themselves. But I guess that the same Rossi ended up without making this kind of autonomous architecture. Probably seeing this afternoon also the images of Galaratese, still in Galaratese you could speak of autonomy. You could say the sense of a longitudinal structure is able to hold houses as well as seats or whatever, and is this sense of indifference that he liked to speak about that actually will keep alive the sense of architecture of whole by itself. But in this moment, I guess that we will try to be much more close to the contingent.
I would just mention that I think that it's not an issue of autonomy more than the idea of architecture itself. Mm. That the Chris talked about the idea of the city, the idea of architecture is what is at stake, I think, in these discussions. The idea that you can actually maintain it and make it still socially relevant, you know, that seems to be more the question rather than autonomy.
Yeah, I want to build on that. It's very interesting that you say that. Here, I'm going to take your position. I'm going to ask question instead of response. So all of us have a certain affinity to the concept of type and typology. And I open these questions to all of you. I wonder, because the question of type is raised, in a sense, as Adrian Fortier has said, at very critical juncture of architecture, when especially when architecture is seen as in crisis, right? And there is actually a larger metacritical project that is at stake in which type lends itself to resolve this issue. So we are all proponents, in a sense, of the concept of type. So I want to just go around and ask, what is in your opinion, do you think is at stake today? And how type plays into that? How type assists that to find a certain resolution to what's at stake?
Can I start? Because I think... I can. I've got something for this one. This was a very explicit framing that came up in the doctoral research group that we were involved in, back in 2006 and 2007 with Larry Barth. And the question there was always, what's type's role in urban transformation? And it was the work we were doing was looking at defining and clarifying for ourselves the relationship between architecture and the city. And to do that, we experimented with, and I'm continuing that, with defining architecture not as a knowledge but as a discipline, as a material and formal skill set that gets deployed and called in to serve knowledge in different ways. So that's why when I talk about the typological burden, I speak about the ground is the object of architecture, which is also working, which works alongside and materializes the idea of the ground as a strategy within urban reform, which works with the concept of the housing project. These are all Foucauldian terms in an idea of a structure of knowledge. And when I speak about that, it's not the same as speaking about the discipline of architecture. So in one sense, it almost sounds like I'm downgrading architecture, right? I'm saying it doesn't have this epistemologically specific knowledge set that it owns. But when we were looking instead at, then how do you speak about architecture's relationship to real transformation, not just novel churn in the city? And so that then, for me and for my colleagues I was working with, I think that's where the idea of a diagrammatic thinking about type came in, that type is a reference to past solutions to similar problems, a way of thinking in categories and groups. It's part of a reasoning process and the design process. It's fundamental to it, and it relies on a diagrammatic capacity for organisational experimentation. You know, and those two things can't be separated. That's how we found it useful.
I think maybe it's to answer the question, I should also clarify and go back to something that was raised earlier, which is the idea of the diagram. And I still feel like there's actually two different ideas of what is a diagram here. I think on one hand, there is, like, let's say, a Foucauldian, Deleuzian idea of a diagram. And, you know, it's a term that they use to describe something that's kind of difficult to describe because you can't really see it, but it's real because it has effects. And it holds together a series of very diverse, heterogeneous things, planning codes, certain kinds of building practices, technologies, buildings, architecture, et cetera, et cetera. And those things have effects. And they organize life in certain kinds of ways. They organize our activities. They organize the kind of routines, the different kinds of repetitions and habits and stuff that kind of shape us. So they're very important. And then on the other hand, I think there's a diagram understood as a kind of graphic representation. And I think the graphic representation in a way is an attempt to access those more abstract sets of relationships, to somehow to work on them, to know them, but also so that they can enter into some kind of collective, they can form some kind of collective or common object of inquiry, so that we can constitute ourselves as a kind of community of bodies who are working on a kind of shared problem in some way. And I think that's the distinction between those two things is incredibly important. And so therefore my interest in type, and I think type is particularly useful at posing certain kinds of architectural problems that relate to how one accesses something like a sociopolitical diagram. And I think that it's precisely that that makes type useful, even if sometimes, you know, one's reminded of the kind of conversation between Bloch and Benjamin. Sometimes only very, very small changes have these kinds of also quite profound repercussions. And I think in a way that's, you know, that at least that's where my interest lies.
Sorry to speak once more, but I think I need it. In my view, the concept of diagram comes immediately after disappeared the concept of process. The concept of process lives in architectural literature, let's say, throughout the 80s till the early 90s. And then when the concept of process and these to think in buildings just representing what the operation of the designer has been ends up as dead end, then the concept which replaces that as a matter of providing the weapon to the architects to go ahead is the concept of diagram. And then the concept of diagram, it comes out for filling up this gap and saying, well, the architects are even resisting the idea of this generality that has the type. Let's keep the ability to transform diagrams in buildings. And probably that is something that clearly comes directly the just transferring to the others the way Renkul has works. And then diagrams enter just as a kind of a bit more active way of dealing with the graphic device. And therefore, I wouldn't give too much value to the concept of diagram that just allowing to clarify and to, let's say, to establish some kind of logic of contiguities or just and that could be also very easily to be physically established in two or three dimensions, and that therefore architects see that as a very easy way of going to.
But no, I think it's true. It's a very abused term and form of representation.
Also the resistance to admit how much architects has been working in the 90s with just looking for iconographic strikes. Instead, just where there is iconography could be the way of hiding a diagram. Mm. And then that also could be said that happens very often. But therefore, for me, it's an overvalued concept.
Actually, to be quite honest, I hadn't been thinking about type for a long, long time. I had continued interest. I had continued interest in the diagram in the forms of, you know, grids and axes and the way that architects work but then Sam sort of called me up and said that we're going to have a symposium on the type, and that he was very interested in the way that I had, you know, elaborated type through the diagram, and so, oh, okay, I did that. And and so I titled it The Diagrammatic Construction of Type, and I thought through it, and I confirmed, yes, I think Sam's reading is correct, and that I will sort of reconfirm it. But then today in the morning, Rafael made a very strong sort of statement of position, you know, stated that particularly with Durand, you know, he was sitting next to me and whispering, you cannot do type with Durand. And I understand that. I understand why there is a problem with Durand, and that, you know, we were talking amongst us and, you know, we can agree on that. And I was thinking why, at the same time, I was holding on to, why we hold on to Jerome as a kind of a figure that opened up or collapsed type and diagram. And for me, I think rather than using type as a kind of idea of stability, actually, for me, I think the continued interest in both diagram and type is because of the instabilities of the cultural situation, social cultural situation, in where I usually practice and teach. And in that kind of situation, I think it applies to Singapore, to China, to Korea, to a lot of places where there has been historical, fundamental historical discontinuities. And so type is sort of hearkened, and there's always this danger of nostalgia. But at the same time, type is sort of considered as a kind of mechanism in which you can sort of think about architects. The whole idea of architecture can somehow exist. But that we have no illusions in that region that we have these stable, you know, types and historical continuities. And so the diagrammatic idea of the diagrammatic construction of type, that the type is a kind of open field where there are certain possibilities of continuities. They might be very fragmentary, but at the same time you want to sustain the notion of type, understanding that it's a very different kind of construction from the Western tradition. And the way that one can possibly do that is to bring in the idea of the instrumentality of the diagram, of the wayward nature of it. And that's why I concluded in the past few hours why I wanted to collapse type and diagram. So it might be something very different from what Sam was sort of trying to get at, but somehow we met. By coincidence, not by coincidence, but by a certain interest, I think. Peter.
One, two, three, yeah. I had a few points. There was a certain vagueness still in the discussion, and I wanted to offer some distinctions. And the first distinction I would offer is the distinction between function types, functionally defined types, and formal / spatial types. And it seems to me that, and the other suggestion is, the second suggestion is, let's illustrate what we mean by type and naming a few types, which adds up. I'm not sure if these would add up to typology, but I start naming. You mentioned basilica. You said Basilica Church. I can say something like courtyard house. Mm. We can say something like a villa type versus row houses. Mm. And then I can go into modern era, say tower block, slab, perimeter block. Now, and to some extent, these are sedimented types. They don't add up to a systematic taxonomy, particularly if I pick up from what Chris says, that they have to be empirically accruing, but that doesn't make a taxonomy to some extent. And where does that leave us as architects who want to work with typologies? When we work as architects, we want to open up a repertoire of options, and that means we would think of a system of options, and then we can be locked at that moment to what is empirically accruing, which is a kind of Chinese encyclopedia. We would have to start to establish a kind of taxonomy of options, and at that point we enter the modern era, and Durand is part of that, pre-modern, where what you don't have anymore, what you had in tradition, what grows these types in the empirical sense is in fact, I believe, stable form function fusions or complexes. And only rarely is something like the basilica, which maybe exists in a market and in a church, but usually you have these kind of form-function fusions, and that makes for enormous stability. Certain cultures have only three or four types for hundreds and hundreds of years, like the, you know, a Chinese courtyard house as a residence and place of work, and there's only maybe set against that a kind of market square and the government monument, and that's and all of these are form function fusions. I think what is important then when we enter the pre-modern and modern is that the distinction of form and function becomes instrumental, which is actually the founding lead distinction of the disciplines, where the form-function fusion is becomes problematic, and we are now having the task of giving form to function, problematizing these, and unfolding a series of formal options and mapping them against a kind of taxonomy of increasingly proliferating functions. And I think that's, for me, important. And I think somebody who's tried that, I mean, I've tried to do that in my book, and Alejandro tried that in the kind of politics of the envelope, where you start to create a kind of taxonomy. We can do a taxonomy of urban types on in the spatial thing. We can say perimeter block, slab, tower, etc. And they are just geometric envelope types. Mm-hmm. And I can expand that. And in the end, they seem to be eternal, everything seems to fall into this, but it's not because they're kind of essential cultural icons, because this is simple geometry of having z-axis privileged, that is a tower, two axis z and y privileged, and one reduced a slab, all three privileged, and it kind of becomes a volume, so you have point, line, horizontal, vertical, plane, volume, in this case you have a taxonomy which opens up the total spectrum of geometric options, but as purely formal types, and now you can start to think what functional social effects these might have. I think that's what I want to throw in. Just to summarize, we have to distinguish formal types from functional types, or whether we're talking about form-function fusions. Second point, we need to distinguish whether you're just listing empirically accrued types which become a kind of Chinese encyclopedia which we can't work with. And the third is, we need to, if we want to think and work with typology, I think we need to construct taxonomies, I mean full-fledged typologies in the domain, I think, of the formal, spatial. And we cannot in the contemporary, I think, believe in that these kind of form-function fusions are very stable today. So the last point I want to make is that in the contemporary, this whole category comes highly problematic and fluid, and seems to be set against the grain of and thrust of our era.
But Patrick, I think that listening to you, I will say that I understood better what means a row house, a tower, the courtyard, or which was the latest one that you mentioned, of the row houses.
The perimeter block. I mean, it's very important to have to name what we mean.
I understood better the type, just in words, that just drawn. I don't need that. As soon as you are drawing a row house type, you are lost. And yet, I understand perfectly that I agree, and we can't agree in saying that there are those initial types that have a name and have a word just describing them better, that as soon as you put that in geometry, as soon as you put that in a geometry, you are killing the lure and the potential of the form, I would say. When you are talking about row houses, I am ready to admit that in spite that I don't want to draw the diagram of the row houses, I have in mind the memories of so many row houses I had, and I am able to enter figures and numbers and dimensions and so on. Talking about the instability, and probably I think that on the way, it seems to me that you allude to that also. Probably we are living times where it is much more difficult to see the shape of the time, because probably, let's say, life of things close to us is shorter than it was before. I mean, and probably the generations to come to have much more difficulties in understanding exactly how was going to be visually categorized, let's say, the first decade of 21st century, that, let's say, the 1920 in Paris. You come very clearly in terms of this family of objects, able to find out quite a rich collection of what happened in Paris in 1920s, and it would be much more difficult to find out what happened in London in the first decade of the 21st century. Not even in whatever, in fashion, and therefore, I guess that for better or worse, we need to live, to use to live in a more unstable world. I mean, in a way, you have patterns. This morning, when we have seen some images of four or five atriums, four or five public spaces, those public spaces are completely formless somehow, and completely just the result of the accumulation of just this diversity that probably qualifies a bit what it is today. Today, we are much more trying to avoid the style that whatever. I mean, that happens when you look at the treatment of the interior designs of Rem, would agree with that purposely he's trying to fool and to make equivocal statements about when the walls are talking of some geometry, the carpets are talking of just, mechanical reproduction of nature. And then it is this willingness of just offering the image of a certain inconsistency would actually characterize the time, and therefore it's going to be much more difficult to grasp what, even we live in this instability with all the machines we have in the pocket. I mean, you are not, at the end, you are not keeping any image. You kept much more clearly photographed, let's say, 25 years ago than just now, where you have thousands of photographs in your cell phone, and yet, well, anyway.
No, I think actually the idea of kind of informality and diversity and this kind of lack of clarity that you described is probably a very fitting note to bring the symposium to a conclusion. Thank you very much to our guests for participating today, and to the audience for sticking out for a very, very long day. So if everybody could put their hands together.